Hachette Audio presents The Russian Revolution, A New History, written by Sean McMeekin, read by Pete Larkin. Please enjoy the PDF of photos that accompanies this audiobook. For Isla and Errol. A note on dates, names, translation, and transliteration. The Russian Revolution, like both of the 20th century world wars, wrought havoc with place names as cities and entire regions changed hands between empires, from empires to nation states, and sometimes back to empires again. Moscow mysteriously escaped the nomenclature revolution. But this is one mercy among endless headaches. Because St. Petersburg was Petrograd and not yet Leningrad, from 1914 to 1924, that is what it is for most of the book. With other cities, I have used the contemporary form with modern usage in parentheses. Thus, Reval, Tallinn. In more politically sensitive cases, I have offered three versions on first usage, as in Lemberg, Lvov, Lviv. Today's Istanbul was called Constantinople in the period covered in the book, even by Ottoman government officials, and so that is the name we use. Although the Republic of Turkey did not come into formal existence until 1923, I refer to Turkey and the Ottoman Empire interchangeably before that date, as many Turks and most Russians and Europeans did at the time. Dates provide an especially vexing problem in modern Russian history, in that the Julian calendar the empire used was first 12, then 13 days behind the Gregorian one used in the West, to which the Bolsheviks switched in January 1918, right in the middle of the Russian revolutionary drama. For dates prior to this, important in both Russian and European history, I have tried to give both dates with a slash, as in November 1st, 14th, 1916, where the 1st is the Julian and the 14th the Gregorian date. In 1917, when dates start coming fast and furious and the specifically Russian context becomes paramount, I switch over to the Julian calendar owing to the importance of months in revolutionary terminology. February Revolution, April and July days, October Revolution, before following the Bolsheviks in switching to the Gregorian in mid-January 1918. To guide readers, signposts will be offered when these switches are made. For Russian language words, I have used the Library of Congress transliteration system, with a somewhat modified version for names. It has been my customary practice in the past to make exceptions only for standard spellings of famous surnames, for example, Milyukov, not Milyukov. And yet, this seems unfair to others. With apologies to Russian specialists, I have applied these changes broadly in the main text, starting Russian names with U, Y-U, not I-U, Yusupov, not Yusupov, and Ya, not Ya, Yakov, not Yakov. Which rule also eliminates double initials for first names and patronymics. Iu and Ia are two letters in Latin, one letter in Cyrillic. I have also ended names with Y, not I-I, Trotsky, not Trotsky-E, and X, not K-S, Felix, not Felix. I have done likewise with names where a close English rendering is common, such as Alexander, not Alexandre, and Peter, not Petre, Piotr. Mikhail and Nikolai are spelled and pronounced differently enough in Russian that I have left these alone, unless affixed to an anglicized title, such as Grand Duke Michael or Grand Duke Nicholas. In accordance with convention, I have also used Izvestia, not Izvestiya, and Novovremya, not Vremya, in the main text, although following Library of Congress spellings in the source notes. Soft and hard signs are left out of the main text, so as not to burden the reader. The goal is to make it as easy as possible to read Russian names and to remember them. It is impossible to be consistent in all these things. May common sense prevail. All translations from the French, German, Russian, and Turkish, unless I am citing another translated work or note otherwise, are my own. Introduction. The first century of the Russian Revolution. Like 1789, when the French Revolution erupted, 1917 has entered the lexicon of world historical dates all educated citizens are expected to know and remember. The meaning of 1917, however, remains much contested, not least because two very different revolutions took place in Russia that fateful year. The February Revolution toppled the Russian monarchy and ushered in a brief era of mixed liberal and socialist governance, only to be superseded by the more radical October Revolution, which saw Lenin's Bolshevik party impose a communist dictatorship and proclaim an open-ended world revolution against capitalism and imperialism. Each of these developments was significant enough to merit serious historical study. Together, they constitute one of the seminal events of modern history, which introduced communism to the world and paved the way for decades of ideological conflict, culminating in the Cold War of 1945 to 1991. Because the Bolsheviks were avowed Marxists, our understanding of the Russian Revolution has long been colored by Marxist language, from the idea of a class struggle between proletarians and the capitalist ruling classes, to the dialectical progression from a bourgeois to a socialist revolution. Even many non-Marxist historians tended, in the Cold War years, to accept the basic Marxist framework of discussion about the Russian Revolution, concentrating on such matters as Russia's economic backwardness vis-a-vis more advanced Western capitalist countries, the stages of her emergence from feudalism, and her belated industrial development, inequality, and Russia's lopsided social structure, and so on. As late as 1982, Sheila Fitzpatrick, in an influential college textbook titled The Russian Revolution, described Lenin's aim in the October Revolution unambiguously as the overthrow of the bourgeoisie by the proletariat. This relatively uncritical approach to the Russian Revolution proved surprisingly resistant to revision over the decades, in part because the great anti-communist writers of the Cold War years, from George Orwell to Alexander Solzhenitsyn to Robert Conquest, focused on communism in its period of Stalinist maturity in the 1930s and 1940s, not on its origins in the revolution. Serious new studies of the February Revolution did appear, such as George Katkov's Russia, 1917-1967, and Tsuyoshi Hasegawa's February Revolution, 1981. Not until Richard Pipes's The Russian Revolution, 1990, however, was there a serious reappraisal of the revolutions of 1917 as a whole. What happened in Red October, Pipes asserted, was not a revolution, not a mass movement from below, but a top-down coup d'etat, the capture of governmental power by a small minority. Far from being a product of social evolution, class struggle, economic development, or other inexorable historical forces foreseen in Marxist theory, the Russian Revolution was made by identifiable men pursuing their own advantages and was therefore properly subject to value judgment. Pipes's judgment of these men was withering. Coming out at a time when the Soviet Union was in the process of collapsing, Pipes's thoroughly revisionist study acted like a wrecking ball, demolishing any last claim the Russian Communist Party had to democratic, popular, or moral legitimacy. Pipes was even called as an expert witness in the Nuremberg-style trial of the party's crimes convened in 1992 and then quickly abandoned by Russian President Boris Yeltsin's post-communist government. Although many Soviet specialists scoffed at Pipes's revisionist history as irretrievably biased, Pipes had worked as an advisor to the Reagan administration in 1981-1982, no one could ignore it. In the long-running debates about communism between sympathizers and cold warriors, it seemed that the sympathizers had been placed squarely on the defensive, if not routed for good. A quarter century later, there are signs that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.